So I'm going to do a case study with you from here on out. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to invite my wife to come up and help me. From this point on, you're going to help us figure out the beliefs of the person based upon the events. So they're going to have an experience. You're going to tell me what their beliefs are, what their conclusions they made about themselves based upon the event. And then we're going to figure out what their decisions are about themselves. What actions will they then take from that point on? And this will help you connect how a person who's a bully at work has had certain experiences which led to a certain set of beliefs, which led to a certain set of behaviors, came out that way, exactly like someone who's overweight, someone who's a rageaholic, someone who's a controlling, a sarcasticist, a critical, crazy person. All of these people have one common thing. They had specific experiences that which led to a set of beliefs. So Sherry, if you'd want to come up here. Okay, number one, we're going to call this person, these two people, Ralph and Gertie. Everything that you see that comes up in here is something that's happened to a client of mine in just in the last year's worth of time. So nothing here is made up. So this is what happened to Ralph. At age 3, Ralph's dad divorced his mom. Okay, now, audience participation. What does Ralph believe about Ralph? Okay, it's his fault. Anything else?
His dad doesn't care about him.
Dad doesn't care about me. Anything else?
Marriage doesn't work.
Marriage doesn't work. Good call.
Adult men can't be trusted.
Adult men can't be trusted. Easy, John. All right. Therefore, if he believes it's his fault, if his dad doesn't care about him, and marriage doesn't work, and men can't be trusted?
Yeah.
Adult men can't be trusted. What does his behavior look like? What decisions will he make about how he behaves?
He doesn't trust himself.
He won't trust himself. So how does that manifest itself in behavior? He will, okay. Act out, no boundaries. Anything else?
He will believe his relationships will fail.
Okay, so he will self-sabotage all relationships. Good call.
Not love himself.
He won't love himself. Now I want to, while she's writing that, I want to show you something. This is Ralph. This represents the experience of the divorce. We're just putting it in as the foundational rock to Ralph's. This is his subconscious. This is the memories that he's storing inside of his subconscious. Okay. Now we're using this as our model. That's why it's on the wall there. All right, now, Sherry, I'd have you do both sides. That would be easier. Okay, Gertie. Gertie was sexually molested by her uncle at age 5. What are Gertie's beliefs? What are her conclusions she's making about herself?
Men can't be trusted.
Men can't be trusted.
Family can't be trusted.
Family can't be trusted. Is that what you said? No.
Yes.
Men and family can't be trusted. And why family, just by the way? Why family?
Uncle,
right. And who was there protecting her?
No.
Oh, so is it just her uncle or men? Could be mom and dad too, right? All right.
She's an object.
Gertie's an object, yeah.
But she's bad.
She's bad. Gertie's bad.
Shame.
How would that manifest? How would shame manifest? She shames herself.
Self-sabotage.
She will start, and that would be a behavior, self-sabotaging. This is a good time to explain the difference between guilt and shame. Okay, guilt means... What does guilt mean? Guilt's a positive.
Guilt is fixable.
Guilt is fixable.
Recognition.
Correction. I made a mistake, right? Shame. What's the difference?
I am the mistake.
Guilt is a positive emotion. Shame is self-destructive. I made a mistake versus I am the mistake. Okay, and remember, and we'll cover this again. A mistake is really a mistake that allows a retake. And, you know, in a Christian community, that's where forgiveness comes in, the atonement of Christ. If I make a mistake, Hollywood even does it. They get a retake. Well, the same construct holds true for every man, every woman ever born. That's how we grow. That's how we learn. This is a scientific approach to it. That's how I'm going to learn how to walk. What happens to the child if mom and dad never let them fall? Without the falling, what mistake never gets a retake? They get up and eventually they don't even want your help, do they? They want to be independent of it. Okay, what other actions does Gertie engage in? If she's an object, how will she behave?
She may objectify other people.
I didn't hear that.
She may objectify others.
She could objectify others.
As well as herself.
Say again.
As well as herself.
And she will objectify herself, which means, put in different words.
Not have boundaries.
She has no boundaries. So what will her relationships look like? Go ahead and project into the future.
She'll be very promiscuous.
She'll be promiscuous. So her behavior will be promiscuous, if you can spell that. Okay, so here we go. This is Gertie. So we've just laid the bedrock, the foundation for her behavior. Back to Ralph. After the divorce, Ralph's mother started inviting multiple boyfriends into the house. So the boyfriends that came in started emotionally abusing Ralph. What does he believe about himself? He's worthless. No value. Now here's an important thing.
Mom doesn't love him.
Oh, mom doesn't love him. And dad didn't care earlier.
And so home is not safe.
Home is not safe. Notice the compounding effect now. This is critical. He starts just with the divorce. The divorce then leads to another event that allows him to compound the beliefs he had earlier, which leads to another event which allows him to compound those. The compounding effect gets ingrained inside the subconscious and becomes a permanent neural pathway on which behavior travels. That compounding effect is the very key to what we're trying to understand. Okay, so if he views himself as worthless, now his mother doesn't love him and home isn't safe, what are his behaviors going to look like?
He's going to look for love somewhere else.
He'll search for love elsewhere, other than the home. Okay.
He may try to escape home.
He'll try to escape home.
He'll treat others the way he was treated.
He'll treat others
as he was treated.
Okay, as she's finishing up there, oh, let me put another one for Ralph. Ralph just had another experience. Very good. Okay. Gertie, raped by a friend's dad at age 7. What's she believe about herself?
She's still not good. It's her fault.
It's her fault. Okay, what else?
Can't trust anyone. No family, no friends.
Good. Can't trust anyone. Seen the pattern? See how these things just start compounding each other?
She may believe that she deserves it.
I deserve it. And first person. I deserve it. And this is what happens. We do this. This is how we start self-sabotaging. And most of the things that I'm talking about will be occurring below the radar screen. Okay, so how will she behave now? If it's her fault, I deserve it, I don't have trust for anybody, what's the behavior look like?
Anything goes. She can do anything.
Anything goes.
She's going to manipulate or do whatever it takes to get what she wants.
Whatever it takes, manipulate. Now I'm going to go ahead and add to Gertie's list here, or I'm going to put another experience in, and then I want to show you something interesting. Gertie's family intervenes, grandparents, and say, you know what, we need to get you some religion or we need to get you some counseling. So we're going to go ahead and purify you. We're going to get you a little clean. So we're going to get you clean now. And then they say the same thing to Ralph. So we're going to get you clean too. So we're cleansing them. But what's the problem with my metaphor right now?
It's there. The beliefs and experiences don't go away.
And at the cognitive level, they cannot. And so to go read your scriptures, to say a prayer, to have a come into Jesus moment, or to go to someone just talk about your problems. The problems never stayed there. This is what the problems did. Okay. Now we've talked about your problems. And that's what we're doing. So when we get a motivational speaker to come in and try to change an organizational climate, the culture, to talk to someone who's a little out of control, maybe a bully, or someone who needs a performance evaluation, and we talk them to death. We're simply mixing it up. We're adding some neat stuff. It's motivational. But how long is the shelf life of a motivational talk we talked about? Maybe 2 days, right? And then everything's back to normal. We've just stirred it up a little bit. Okay, let's just do one more so you get the point. All right. Ralph's mother had an open, unfiltered sexual lifestyle. What's he believing about himself?
He
doesn't deserve to be protected. Okay? What's his behavior going to look like?
He's going to have no sexual boundaries at all.
No sexual boundaries at all. Now, we're going to judge him, because you can picture where this is going, right? How will society judge Ralph when he's in his 20s and 30s?
Player.
Or worse. All right. Gertie has sexual contact with dad at 13. Okay, now I'm going to fast forward just this slide. He becomes sexually active at 13, Ralph does, and Gertie has incest with dad from 14 to 17. Here's the story. This is the result of it. It is a common fallacy within our society to drive for affirmation, affection, and approval before we have mutual trust and respect in a relationship. So we go through life searching, thank you, Sherry, we go through life searching to get the affection because every one of us as humans want to connect. It's innate. It's inbred within us. So because we want to connect, we'll start connecting with anyone, anyhow, any way, as long as we're not getting it. So it becomes insatiable. But what we've learned is that the connection of the three A's is only satiable if it comes through mutual trust and respect. So let me give you a definition of love that's really held true for me in all the studies I've done. Love is based on a foundation of mutual trust and respect where one recipient looks for the good in the other. Okay, just hold on to that for a second. Now consider this. Sherry and I are having dinner and I profess my undying love for my bride. And then I say something to the effect, you know, you really need to improve upon a few things. Could we go ahead and have a chat about that? Because I think I could help you to really improve on a few things in your life. Okay, now, let's just play a word game. If love is to see the good in others. Now, you guys are laughing because you know I would never do that, right? That's why you're laughing, right? It wouldn't go too well anyway.
I don't know if she'd allow it.
So, if love is to see the good in others, what's the antithesis? To see the bad in others. So if love is to see the good and to see the bad in others, then would be? Just put it in perspective. Now, I know husbands or wives who criticize their spouses don't hate their spouses. But by semantic definition, is that not the behavior manifestation? So putting into perspective what's going on, if you want to develop relationships first with yourself and then with others that are integrated in nature, the idea is you first establish trust and respect in the story. And through trust and respect, you will gain what's called intimacy. But if you try to go the other way, now, those of you who've seen 14-year-old teenagers in operation, especially girls, masters at gaining the three A's. They live for the three A's. They dress for the three A's. They talk for the three A's because they have no foundation. That's because they're not connecting with mom and dad as a general rule. Therefore, there's an attachment issue, and they become peer-centric instead of parent-centric. And therein is our problem, I see, not only in organizations, but in society. We're all going around the world trying to get someone to affirm us, so we talk in a way to get you to like me, to affirm me, to show affect toward me, or to approve of my behavior, versus establishing a relationship based on trust and respect, starting with self-respect. All right, I need to read you a story. In order to understand this model, oh, by the way, I forgot. We had lots of experiences with Ralph and Gertie here. So I'm going to put in a number of experiences for Ralph, a number of experiences for Gertie. These are beautiful experiences, nicely colored. They had lots of therapy, lots of coming to Jesus moments.
Lots of marriages.
Okay, yeah, we're doing well. We got a nice brew going on here. Yeah, we'll just let that sit there. All right. Remind me, I just put this in my pocket. I have a tendency not to remember. Anyone see what I do with my glasses? Ha. Okay. So we're going to describe, actually, Sherry, I'm going to have you hold this and switch it when I need you to. We're going to go over this victim trap, so I need to set a few things for you. Notice that, number one, within the victim trap, there's three players. This is actually a card game we play in our homes, in our families. Each of us plays it, and each of you will take a different role on. So I want to explain what the roles are so you understand this. So every single person, from victim to persecutor, persecutor to rescuer, and rescuer to victim, have unclear boundaries. We've just got a litany of why we have unclear boundaries inside of a family. Click. The victim will always feel self-blame. They live in a personal pity party. That's their place of residence. And they will always use pity as love. They don't know the difference. Now imagine if two people marry each other who both live inside the victim world. All they know is pity as love. How are they going to treat their children? Now, the rescuer lives inside the martyr world, and the persecutor lives in the world of self-righteous. By the way, persecutors are always right. If you ever met someone who's always right, high probability they're a persecutor. Go and flip. Now, go ahead and read those under subtitles as I tell you the story. On Easter, Barbara, the sister of our star in the story, Marty, invited everyone to her house for dinner. Marty did not want to go because after several months of learning these constructs, she was aware of what we call the victim game. She was, however, persuaded, notice the word, by Barbara through guilt, the all-purpose family tool that gets just about anyone to do anything. Marty, knowing the victim game well, talks of how she had to suffer to go to the Easter dinner. So she's telling the story, and this is what's going on inside the story. Quote, my husband had just finished a 36-hour work-a-thon, and we hadn't seen each other in 4 days. But we made the long drive, it was 300 miles, just to see the family and to make Barbara happy. And the minute we walked in the door, Mother ruined everything. Soon after we walked in, Mother began talking about how I never used to help with the dishes and that tonight I was expected to do the dishes. Now that's how she was greeted at the door after a 300-mile drive. Okay, just for a second, what's going on inside of Marty's mind?
Why did I come?
I'm going to break those dishes. Okay. All right. That set the evening up for the game. Marty became defensive, and the minute you go defensive, are you this way or are you this way? Okay. So the minute you go into defensive posture, you're already fragmented. She said nothing aloud, but this is what's going on inside of her mind. You crazy old witch. I've always done the dishes. You're the one who's never done anything. You've always treated us like slaves. We had to do everything so that you and Dad could argue and fight all night. So what's the narrative now? Just think in your mind, what are her beliefs and what are her behaviors through her whole life towards Mom and Dad? We were never really allowed to be children because you had so many damn kids that there was no end of the work. I've never done the dishes. You're nuts. Now, that's her narrative inside of her head. She's saying that to herself. By her first statement, the mother pushed Mary into the victim role by persecuting her. Do you see how it's working on the board there? Marty feels victimized and responds mentally by persecuting her mother. So though she views herself as the victim, she now goes on the attack and becomes the persecutor. The evening is already ruined and it hasn't even begun. After a few minutes, Marty is steaming and takes Barbara into the kitchen. Barbara's her sister. And she lets it all out on Barbara, blaming her for always trying to get the family together when she knows they all hate each other. So now Marty's given heck to Barbara in the kitchen. But the mother's out in the living room listening to Barbara get heck from Marty. So what's the mother got to do? She's got to run in and watch the chaos that she created. People of lesser persona, if you will, you know, they have to create, foster, foment the process so they can run in and start rescuing. There's our victim trap. I'm not going to finish the story, but you get the gist. Every one of us, to some degree or another in our lives, have participated in that. Critical aspect is knowing that it exists. And so when mom, dad, brother, sister, spouse, whoever, gets into your space and they go, here, want to play a card game with me? Here's what we typically do. We go, no, not interested. I need two cards. And off we go to the races. Because on that first comment, Marty went from this to this and never came back. End of the story was within 5 minutes of mom re-entering the kitchen and before dinner, Marty and her husband drove 300 miles back home. Wonderful holiday experience. Thank you. Okay. So we're going to continue the story of Ralph and Gertie just to bring things full circle. So now notice the compounding effect. Ralph then gets bullied as a kid. He's small, he's quiet, and so on the playground at school, he gets picked on a lot. Gertie starts using her body and sex as a way to get attention, to meet her needs. Ralph went from being bullied, the target, to being the bully in high school and college. Short-term relationships for Gertie, and they were all based upon sex. Ralph gets a corporate job and rises quickly. Now, here's my research. We actually, in the corporate world today, reward bullies because they get things done now. Because the corporate mindset is short-term, not long-term, and they do not look at the P&L other than exactly the black and white without inferring what the statistics mean behind the constant turnover. An average target will spend 52% of his or her day avoiding the bully. Now that's not even built into the 2 times the annual salary cost of losing the target. So assuming that I'm the one getting targeted and John, for whatever reason, you're my bully, I will spend 52% of my day avoiding you. So if my annual salary is $50,000, how much is the company losing during the course of every day or every year? That's not even built into the equation. All right. Gertie, multiple date rapes. The problem is the date rapes turn into boyfriends. Okay? Ralph becomes a bully at work, and Ralph is a bully at home, and they get married. So, here we go. We have multiple events coming down the road. Okay, so let's just take one each. And Ralph gets counseling for his rage. Gertie goes to church. These guys are just going to get it together. They want to make this marriage work, so we got to mix it up. Notice we have yet to take away the experiences that either one of them had. The experiences still exist, but we're trying to cleanse them with motivational speeches, going to church, read your scriptures, and we're trying to cleanse them through a little bit of chat therapy. Okay, so now that we got these guys nice and cleaned up. All right, wonderful, wonderful. Now, they have a child. We take a little bit of Ralph. And we take a little bit of Gertie. And now we have Junior. This is called an epigenetic transfer. Every experience that Ralph has had, every experience that Gertie has had, will now be transferred through the DNA into their offspring until it gets cleaned up. And now we have a multi-generational process of Ralph and Gertie's running around the world, and they will then perpetuate by marrying another Ralph and Gertie because they will attract that type of a person. Ralph will marry his mother. I'm sorry, Ralph's boy will marry his mother. If they have a girl, he'll probably marry his dad. She'll marry his dad. And they'll go back and forth, and generationally, their grandchildren will be just like they are, and they will not be able to understand why. But they will be highly critical of the parents' techniques about how they raised them. So after 3 years, they get divorced. Ralph loses custody of the boy. And that's what our boy looks like.